Hi, family. Welcome back to another episode. If you like what you've been hearing, don't forget to subscribe, give me a thumbs up, and tell your friends about us. Now sit back and enjoy the show. Story 1. Terrifying Childhood. From the time I was 4 until I was about 16, my grandparents lived in a house that had a poltergeist in it. I lived with them for the first 4 years and then moved out with my mother. But even after we moved, I would spend the weekends or holidays at my grandparents' house. The happenings were noticed by everyone in the family. My grandfather was the only one who never said anything was out of the ordinary. He was a staunch man of God and kept pictures of Jesus everywhere. He prayed daily to bless the house and everyone in it. The house had a sunroom that had been added onto the second floor over the front porch. This became my room. The wall between my bedroom and the master bedroom, where my mother slept, was brick. It had two small windows on either side of the door. I had to walk through her room to get to the upstairs hallway, where there was a door leading to the middle room, which was always dark because there was only a window, and that window was 2 feet from the house next door. The back of the upstairs had a small kitchen over top of one of the first floor rooms, and a bathroom at the very back, over top of my grandparents' room on the first floor. The downstairs had a living room-dining room combination that was curtained off. The front room was a bedroom. The middle room was a dining room. The stairs to the basement went down at the doorway to the kitchen, just beyond my grandparents' room, as I mentioned. My grandparents, my mother, my aunts, and myself all lived there at the same time. My aunts were teenagers. They were experimenting with the occult, spirit invocations, and things of that nature. I really think that this had a lot to do with everything that went on in this house. At their age, they really couldn't have understood the consequences of what they were doing and what they were asking. You could clearly hear footsteps in the middle bedroom, even during the day when no one was in there. So many things got moved around in the middle room that eventually she put a lock on her door, but realized after she put a lock on the door that it was nobody else in the house that was moving her things around. We heard walking, someone laying down heavily on her bed, drawers opening and closing, the closet opening and closing. Not loud or frightening, just normal noises, like someone was in the room. But no one was in the room, and the door was locked. Many times when I was very young, I would scamper up the stairs, convinced that she was there, wanting to play with her, but when I got to her door, it'd be locked, and no one would answer when I knocked. Once, I even saw a light was on in her room. It was shining around the door. I called to her and tried to open the door, but the light went out, and the noises stopped. This would make my scalp tingle with fear. I would run crying to my grandmother and tell her what happened. Once, when I was around 5 or 6, I got up to go to the bathroom in the middle of the night. My room was awash with street lamp light, but my mother's was very dark. I had to go slowly, even though I was dying to go to the bathroom, because I didn't want to crash into something and wake her up. When I got to the bathroom, I was just flushing when suddenly I was possessed with the most abject horror for no apparent reason. I screamed and screamed and screamed and ran all the way from the bathroom past my mother, who was struggling to get up out of bed, into my room and under my blankets. I was trembling and pale and shaking. It woke up the whole house, and it took me hours to calm down and go to sleep, with the lights on. I never figured out what had set me off, just blind panic. Sometimes, our pots and pans could be heard falling out of the cupboards, but when you'd go check, everything would be in its place, except for maybe one thing. That thing would turn up days or weeks later, right back where it should be. My mother saw a black shadow, maybe 2 or 3 feet high, at the foot of her bed. She would see this sometimes when she'd wake up in the middle of the night. One day, it waited until she was fully awake, then slowly, deliberately, came around the side of the bed and advanced towards her head. She prayed fervently while it just stayed there, then mysteriously faded away. But it always came back. She was the only one that saw that thing. The rest of us just heard disturbances. I was playing with my toys one sunny day in my room. I was about 7. I picked up a bunting bag, which is sort of like a baby sleeper. It's a gown that's sewed close at the bottom instead of having legs. It was made of flannel and had flowers on it. I loved putting my baby dolls in it. It fit the ones that were about 12 inches high. I had a doll prepared to put in it and reached for the flannel bag next to me on the floor. Then I shrieked and jumped, flinging it away from me. I could feel there was something snake-like, withering inside of it, making a buzzing sound like the world's biggest housefly. I stared at it in horror as it lay on the floor, withering and twitching. Then the noise stopped, and so did the movements, and the bunting went flat. I was screaming for help. My mom and my aunt came upstairs, and I told them what happened. I was sobbing so hard they could barely understand me. They picked it up, even though I screamed and begged them not to, and they looked inside. Of course, there was nothing. The only way out of this thing was through the neck hole. If there had been something in it, I would have seen it, slithering out. And I had not taken my eyes off the thing, not even for a second. They searched the room and found nothing. They said I must have imagined this, and took me downstairs to have juice to drink. I never played with that bunting again. I put it in the bottom of a box, and left a pile of heavy toys on top of it. The house still stands. And when we left, none of those things followed us. But I wonder what has happened there in the 20 years since I last lived there. Story 2. Infestation. I've always been fascinated by the paranormal. I can remember as a small child, breathlessly poring over books about ghosts, hauntings, and the paranormal. Although I can't recall what the first book I read was, I can remember being totally enraptured, exploring the subject. I quickly exhausted my little elementary school resources, although sometimes I'd read the books on paranormal activity over and over again. As I grew older, my interest did not lessen, and my own personal library was becoming quite large, with both fiction and nonfiction books. I began to entertain the thought of becoming a parapsychologist, although not very seriously. I would read late into the night, sometimes scaring myself silly. If I fell asleep while reading one of these trash books, as they were called by my mother and grandmother, I'd wake up, do the inevitable lecture on filling my mind with such inappropriate things. Still, my interest did not lessen. I did, however, never consider that myself would become a victim of subjectivity. The house I lived in was fairly new. No one close to me had died near the vicinity of my home. We were religious people, and ghosts seemed to be reserved for the attics of old Civil War plantations or abandoned cemeteries. Even so, I was sure, from reading and watching books and movies, that I would move directly out of any house that showed any sign of being haunted. I believed this until the summer of 1990, when my attitude on the subject took a severe change. To my shock and horror, the week before her 40th birthday, my mother died suddenly. In an instant, my whole life changed. Coupled with the horrible grief I was experiencing at losing my mother, my family structure was also changing. Within the same week, my sister moved in with my maternal grandparents next door. They had always been like guardian angels to she and I. My stepfather immediately rented an apartment and moved out of our home to distance himself from the pain of losing his wife. I was left all alone in the house. By my choice, of course, but all alone the same. Although my grandparents lived only a few hundred yards away, they seemed a million miles away when I walked into that empty house at night. My world had fallen around me. The first event in my house happened 2 weeks after my mother's funeral. An old friend of mine, we'll call him Mike, and I were reunited by my mother's death after nearly 2 years of not speaking to each other. It was not rare for him to stay over in my sister's old bedroom after a night of talking, crying, and catching up on what time we had spent away from each other. One Sunday morning, Mike had paid me a visit after going to church. Mike was devoutly religious. He was accompanied by a friend named Kyle, who I'd only met once before. We began talking and laughing, and ended up listening to some old comedy albums on the stereo in my bedroom. It seemed like a great morning. Since we were listening to recordings, we were all pretty quiet. So I was quite shocked when Mike looked up and said, "Well, aren't you going to see what she wants?" "What are you talking about?" I asked, confused. "Your grandmother's in the living room. She just called for you," Mike replied. I immediately got up from where I was sitting and went into the living room of my house. It was not strange to me that my grandmother would have been in my house unannounced, since she lived right next door and was accustomed to just popping over at any given time. I was, however, quite surprised when I found no one there. I checked the entire house, calling my grandmother's name, and then went back into my bedroom with an odd look on my face and explained to Mike and Kyle that there was absolutely no one other than the three of us in the house. Mike protested, claiming that he had heard her calling my name repeatedly. Problem solving to its best, I turned and went to the phone and called my grandmother. She immediately answered her phone. She denied being in my house and had just came in from mowing her lawn. I explained the situation to her and she laughed it off, saying that the voice that Mike had heard must have came from our neighbor's home, which incidentally is a good 500 yards away, or that we had had a little too much to drink the night before. I was more confused than ever, but not really bothered by the situation. I went back to my bedroom to give the guys an update on my conversation. Mike immediately went pale and said, "There was somebody in this house. There was a voice. It was calling your name, and it was a woman. Therefore, it was either your grandmother or your sister." My sister was in New Orleans at the time. Kyle popped up and said, "I know you don't know me very well, but I know what I heard. There was a woman in the house, and she was calling your name. I still can't get over the fact that you didn't hear it, because it was very loud, and it came from the vicinity of your living room. So, if you're playing a joke on me, it's becoming increasingly unfunny." Trying to ease the situation, I replied, "Look, it must have been the neighbors, so let's forget all about it. No harm done." Mike looked nervous and scared, stating again that he had definitely heard a voice, and that it came from inside the house, not the neighbors, a good distance away. Kyle was also extremely nervous and expressed his desire to leave. After further discussion and me trying to calm them down, Mike and Kyle left my home, and I went back to my everyday activities without giving it much thought. Until 2 Sundays later. It was in the afternoon, and I was on the phone with a good friend of mine. I was sitting in the recliner located in the living room, clothed only in my underwear, a privilege granted to me by the fact that I now live alone. I was chatting away, quite happy, about a party we were planning at my house for the following Saturday, and all of a sudden, I heard a woman's voice saying something from the adjoining kitchen. I was so surprised that I didn't really pay attention to what was being said. I was more concerned about the fact that I had no clothes on, and there was someone in my house. I immediately dropped the phone, leapt out of the chair, and grabbed a large t-shirt that I had draped over a piece of furniture. As I was doing this, I said, "Who's there?" There was no answer. I walked into my kitchen, and there was no one there. The kitchen door was still latched, and my house was silent. My grandparents were away for the afternoon, visiting other relatives. My sister had went with them. I was feeling pretty spooked, and went back to the phone, and said, "You will never believe what just happened." "Who's there?" my friend replied. "No one. There isn't anyone here." My friend on the phone said, "But I just heard a woman talking to you." Feeling a little relieved that I was not losing my mind, I told her that I had heard it too, and asked if she had heard what was said. She said that she could only say that it sounded like my mother or my grandmother. Their voice inflections were very similar. I told my friend that my grandmother was out of town and that there was nobody in the house but me. My friend gave me the best advice I could think of at the time. She said, "Get out of the house." I immediately hung up the phone and left as quickly as possible. I was very afraid, and I stayed at my grandparents' the whole afternoon. My grandparents returned at 5 p.m. that evening, and they were immediately confronted by a seemingly irrational grandson. I told them about the situation. My grandfather, a gentleman who was badly affected by my mother's death, listened up to the part where I said it sounded like my mother's voice. He then became uncharacteristically angry and yelled at me, insisting that I get my butt home and be sure to never talk about this again. My grandmother said nothing, so I begrudgingly went home. Cautiously, I walked in, and for a while I was too scared to make a sound, still trying to piece together, in my mind, what had happened. My friend had told a good number of people about the incident, so by the time the party rolled around on Saturday, everyone was interested in my ghost, who they had decided to call George. I don't know why they picked a male name when it was a female voice that we had heard. At one point, Karen and Mike were retelling their stories to a group of about 15 people. One girl was particularly spooked, got up and said, "I want to go to the restroom. When I come back, I want all of this nonsense stopped. I will not stay in a house that I cannot sleep in. And George, I will not let you ruin a perfectly good party. Keep yourself hidden." She then walked away from the group and down the hall. Just as she crossed under the attic door, it fell open and hit her in the back of the head, knocking her to the ground. None of my party guests ended up spending the night, which had been the initial plan. But Karen was nice enough to stay late and help me clean up. The next 2 weeks were relatively quiet. I came home one night to an overflowing bathtub. The lights would occasionally flash on and off. Nothing extremely weird. I was working night while going to school during the day. I usually came home pretty tired. One of these nights I came home, exhausted and hungry. Taking only enough time to fix myself a sandwich, I ate it and went straight to bed. When I walked into my kitchen the next morning, I was quite shocked to find the entire room covered with at least an inch of small, white, styrofoam beads, the kind of which stuffed animals are stuffed with. I stood and stared at the floor for what must have been a half hour. The door was locked, the windows were locked. No one had been able to get in. At some point, I called my grandmother and asked her to come over to the house without telling her what had happened. Sensing it was important, she came right over. She was very confused to see me standing in the middle of a room full of styrofoam pellets. I told her I wanted her to see this for herself and began to explain to her what happened. She resisted as I explained, claiming that I must have been sleepwalking, that I had done it myself. I thought about this for a moment, but then realized that I have no stuffed animals in the house. My sister and I had thrown away all of our childhood toys years ago. There was no stuffed animal casings in the house. Only pelleted beads in the kitchen floor. I don't even know how even 20 stuffed animals could have produced as much stuffing that was on my floor. She had no answers, and we cleaned it up in silence. The next day, I had all the locks on the house changed, and I possessed the only key. I taped hairs across the thresholds of all the windows to make sure that they remained unopened. I was going to figure out what was going on, one way or another. It was about this time that all hell broke loose in my house. It would be impossible for me to recount every single incident that happened over the next year. Lights flashing, doors opening and slamming shut. My stereo, which was now perpetually unplugged, would take a notion to turn itself on every now and then. I heard whispering and laughter. I would find knickknacks moved around the house. Pieces of jewelry would show up out of nowhere. I could set something down, turn around for 2 seconds, and it would vanish. I went through 17 answering machines in 1 year, since they all seemed to malfunction. 4 of them caught fire. I would come home from school or work to find that picture frames had broken. The glass would be shattered all over the house. I had a collection of Chinese corkwood creations enclosed in glass globes on my entertainment center. There was 10 of them. Over the course of a month, they became smashed, one every few nights. The TV would turn on in the middle of the night. Light bulbs would explode for no reason. My clothes would be mysteriously spread across the floor of the house while still on hangers. The rocking chair would rock on its own. The phone would ring incessantly with no one on the other line. I had an audio cassette tape that I had recorded music on. At the very beginning of this tape is jarbled language, which also sounds like speech played backwards, which says very clearly, "My name," and then, "I can't get out of your stomach." But still, event after event occurred, and I was not convinced that my house was haunted. My friends were convinced of it, and when I look back, I'm extremely happy that so many of the events occurred in the full view of others. I've had to call on them many times to verify events. In fact, most of the big stuff happened when I was not alone. But needless to say, my friends slowly stopped coming by. Except for Mike. He did not stop coming over. He once woke me up in the middle of the night insisting that someone had opened the bedroom door, crossed the room, and went into the closet. Upon inspection, the closet door was indeed ajar. Mike slept with a rosary on that night. Mike also gave me a cat. She was a pretty, tabby Persian mix who was as yellow as sunshine. She was affectionate and loving, but she too knew that there was something amiss in this house. She would track empty air with her eyes. She would hiss at walls or arch her back at empty doorways. One day I was sitting in my recliner reading a book when I heard a strange noise. I looked up to see the cat being pulled across the floor. Only there was nothing pulling her. Whatever it was, had her by the back of the neck and was not letting go, but I couldn't see anything. I immediately went to help her, screaming at whatever it was to stop it. I plucked her up from the floor, held her tight, and started crying. I realized that night that my house was definitely haunted. I began to wonder who could be haunting my house. The obvious candidate was my mother. She had died quickly and had been troubled before she died. Yet she was devoutly religious and such a kind, gentle person. It hurt me to entertain the thought that she had not gone on to heaven after such a hard life that she had led. Rather sheepishly, I spoke to our local priest, and he agreed to come and bless my home. The thought of her not being at rest bothered me for a few days, until I had a dream. In the dream, my mother was sitting in my living room, on the sofa. I walked into the room and saw her sitting there and thought, doesn't she know that she's dead and not supposed to be here? In the dream, I immediately picked up the phone to call my grandmother, and while I was explaining to her that Mom was sitting on the couch when she was supposed to be dead, my mother spoke up and said, son, please don't worry. I have gone on, and I'm so happy. So let go of me and stop grieving. I love you. Don't worry about me. When I woke up, with tears on my face, my lights immediately began flashing on and off. I didn't know what was going on, but I was certain that it was not my mother. I decided to move in with some friends in a neighboring town. My grandparents couldn't understand why I decided to move and wanted to leave so badly. I couldn't tell my grandfather the whole story. My grandmother, whom I did tell, just couldn't let herself believe me. I began to pack. During the packing process, everything seemed calm, as if it wanted to make me feel foolish for moving, as if nothing had ever happened. As I was packing, I kept searching for items which it had taken from me during the past year, but I never found any, and all was quiet. I eventually packed up everything but my living room furniture. In order to move some of the heavier items in the living room and all the boxes I had packed previously, my new roommates, Darren and Jason and their friend, came over to spend the night. I rented a couple movies. We ordered pizza. We were planning to get up early the next morning and move these items and disassemble my king-size waterbed. With no other furniture in the house, we piled into my waterbed and slept there. I was nearest the door. I had become an extremely light sleeper over the previous year. The slightest sound woke me up. I slept nearest the door to the living room. All seemed well. The next morning, I woke up before anyone else. I planned on cooking everyone a big breakfast, then began moving things directly after that. I walked into my living room, still sleeping, and was stunned to find that my living room furniture had been turned to face the wall. The huge couch that was 9 feet long and took multiple people to move, the recliner, the love seat, the entertainment center, with everything on it. I was infuriated at first, imagining who could have played such a stupid joke. I was about to wake everyone up when Mike pulled up to the house. He walked in to find me staring at my furniture. We talked about it for some time and came to the conclusion that it was a farewell gift from George. No one else could have gotten out of my bed. I would have felt the movement of the full-motion waterbed if one of them had snuck out past me. No one could have done such a thing with no lights on, and there was no lights turned on in the middle of the night, because that would have woke me up. I would have heard sound coming from the living room. We loaded everything that day for the move, and as I went to close the front door and lock it, I felt a sense of defeat looking at the empty house. I was angry and sad to leave my childhood home, thinking of all the memories it held for me. "Goodbye," I said to the empty house. A bedroom door slammed shut as in response. I moved in with roommates and everything seemed fine for a few weeks. And then the lights began flashing on and off. And items began disappearing. And it seemed that whatever was in the house before had followed me to the new house.